Welcome back, everyone, to the morning show. If you can't take the twists and turns of a roller coaster, you're not alone.
I can't stand roller coasters, but there is a reason why things go round and round and upside down. And our favorite wise guy, Matt Sellen, is here to explain some of the science behind roller coasters.
There's a lot of science in a roller coaster. It's a lot of physics, to be exact. And I was inspired by Disney when we were there, because I went on the Space Mountain ride, which really scared me, because it's all in the dark, and you're going upside down. But anyways, so let me run the car through the roller coaster real quick, and then we'll describe what's going on here.
Quite the setup here.
Right, so this...
Yeah, this Robert thing, was an accompanying fan, and he couldn't ride it, so...
It starts on a big hill, and then it does all these sort of tricks, and it kind of slows down a little bit, and eventually it kind of falls off. Now, you don't want that to happen.
No kidding.
When you're at,
and
you know,
wonder why I'm scared of them.
Six Flags, right? Or something. So the question that I asked last week was, how come you always have the first hill be the biggest hill?
Right.
And the right answer has to do with the fact that you need to have a lot of potential energy to begin with, and so that it has the energy and the speed when it gets to the bottom to make it around all the loops and to make it up the other hills and so on. And Michael Bennett from Decatur sent me the right answer, and he's getting the t-shirt. In fact, it's in the mail right now, so he should be getting that tomorrow.
All right.
And potential energy, now that's the energy that could be had in a situation, sort of, if a car was sitting on the top of the hill.
That's right. Exactly right. So, for example,
I remember something.
Yeah, that's right. So if you pick up a ball and you have it up here and you drop it, it picks up speed, and by the time it gets down some distance below where you dropped it, it's going pretty fast.
Okay.
And that's because it has potential energy up here. That all turns into kinetic energy at the bottom, and those words may sound familiar.
Okay.
And as it turns out, the speed that the thing is moving at the bottom, the square of that speed is proportional to the height. So that means if you want to get going twice as fast at the bottom, you have to have a hill which is four times higher at the beginning. So when you have these enormous roller coasters, even if the roller coaster might be twice as high to begin with as any other one, you're only going twice as fast, or it might be four times as high, it's only going to go twice as fast at the bottom.
And so usually halfway through a roller coaster, there's a part where you get on one of the tracks and it's click, 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 and you're moving back up again.
That's right. Now, the loop thing works this way. We talked about centripetal acceleration and spinning things a little while ago.
Oh, yeah.
Remember?
I
spun the glass of water. If you spin it fast enough, the thing goes around in a circle. If you spin it too slow, it kind of doesn't make it around anymore.
Right.
And so it turns out that the speed you have to spin it depends on the radius of that circle. If it's a bigger circle, you have to go faster.
Okay.
And you need more energy, yeah.
You need more energy. So what you have to do to make sure that a roller coaster is going to work is you have to make sure that the car starts off well above the top of the loop. In fact, the distance is another half a radius above the loop, it turns out. So what's going to happen, now just watch this thing. As it goes around, it loses a little bit of energy each time because of friction, and eventually the thing sort of does that. Now, on a real roller coaster, the wheels are attached to the track, so that's never going to happen. So you're not.
Well, that makes me feel better.
So
yeah.
You could actually be stuck upside down on a roller coaster, which hopefully isn't going to happen to you.
Oh, now I feel like that high blood pressure thing is coming
back.
Right. Okay.
Okay, so I had the question for next week.
Okay.
I wrote it down because I want to make sure I say it right. It's about swinging. Okay, so suppose you go to the playground with your friend.
Okay.
And you and your friend stand right in front of identical swings, which are the same length, and both of you step backward. Okay, you take one step back, your friend takes two steps back, so your friend starts farther back than you. You sit down at the same time and you start to swing. So your friend swings with a bigger motion than you're swinging with.
Or potential energy.
Right.
Don't give the answer. Go ahead.
Who takes the longest to make one full swing? That's the question.
Okay, I want to see the swings full this weekend. Everybody trying that one. And if you have any questions for the wise guy, wiseguy@uiuc.edu. That is the place to answer the questions and to pose some possible questions for him to answer later here on the morning show. Not a bad day for swinging outside. Robert Reese will have all the forecast details coming up.